St. John's. So wonderful to see each and every one of you as we've gathered here this morning for worship on this first Sunday of Advent. We welcome each and every one of you. At this time, I'd like to invite you, if you have a moment, please take the friendship pads that you see in the pews. Take a moment to fill those out. We especially want to encourage you to do so if this is your first Sunday here at St. John's, because the friendship pads are one of the main ways we get to reach back out to you and get you involved and so many of the wonderful ministries and programs we have here at this church. So we encourage you to take a moment to fill that out as you're able. We want to mention that the flowers in the sanctuary this morning are given to the glory of God and in honor of Alice Baylor's birthday and by Clarence Baylor. We want to mention, especially after last Sunday, that we had such a great response from the Stewardship Sunday in receiving and pledges. We give you thanks for that, and thanks for all that God has provided to this church. And we also want to encourage you, if you have not made your 2023 pledge yet, you can do so by either calling or emailing Nancy Fairgreave in the church office and let her know. We want to remind everyone that has signed up to serve home communion to make sure that you know that there's a meeting on Tuesday, November 29th in Ward Hall from 3:30 to 5. Tuesday, November 29th. This meeting is very important because there will be training and structuring of the teams as we will be serving Christmas communion to the homebound next week. So if you have signed up to help with serving home communion, be sure to meet at this meeting Tuesday, November 29th in Ward Hall from 3:30 to 5. The most reliable way, we want to mention for all those who tune in through live streaming, the most reliable way to see our services is by watching through a variety of ways at our main website at stjaiken.org or through our mobile app. We want to mention to anybody who's watching on our Facebook page that if you're ever having issues with the feed, you can also access the live feed through stjaiken.org and also through the mobile app. Please consider that, and if you have any questions or have any points about the live stream, feel free to contact Beth Hartzell in the church office. We always appreciate the feedback. And now, I invite us all to prepare our hearts for worship this morning.
Thank you.
You may be seated. At this time, we invite Carol and Vince Jones to come forward for the lighting of the Advent candle.
We have endured these past few years and know that there is more to face before us. We don't know if we have the strength to withstand what might be around the next corner. And we wonder who will stand with us, who will have our back, who will occupy our corner.
Who is this with us? That is what we begin to wonder these days. Who will light our way and our chart our course? Who is on our side and who will give us hope?
The prophet Jeremiah speaks of a branch that will be raised. Jesus spoke of a Son of Man that will descend. Both point to hope. Hope that calls us home, our true home, where we are welcomed and loved and included, where there is justice and equality and peace.
We light this candle as a sign of our hope, our strong hope that through the gift of Emmanuel, God with us, there is a way to go home. To the home in Christ. And it starts with us, and it starts here, and it starts now. O come, Emmanuel.
At this time, I invite you to rise as you're able as we affirm our faith with the historic Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From this he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. To come forward for the morning offering. Once the ushers are in place, we invite our children to follow the crucifer out for Children's Church.
Thank you.
Let us join together in prayer. May we pray. O gracious God, prepare our hearts and lives for your advent, for your coming to be among us. O Lord, we long for your coming. We long for the hope that you bring, a hope that sustains us, a hope that is certain, not ambivalent, not transitory, a hope that is eternal in the heavens and on earth. So, Lord, strengthen us with hope so that we might be people of faith, that no matter what our circumstances or what our situation, we know that we can depend upon you. So, Lord, we come before you with humility, bowing before you, the God of hope. We pray that you might forgive us of our sins, that you might cleanse us from all unrighteousness, that you might create in us clean hearts and clean lives. Oh Lord, we pray that you might be with those who especially have been through the valley of the shadow of death, who are facing new difficulties. But Lord, we pray that you will be their hope, that certain assurance, that expectation of deliverance. Lord, have mercy upon each person, every one of us who are in need this day. We thank you, God, for your consistency, your majesty, your love, your greatness, your power. Live in us, create in us, Lord, lives that will honor you this Advent, so that we can be best prepared not only to celebrate your first coming, but to be more prepared than ever for your second coming. For this is our prayer in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, the one who taught his disciples and us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. I'd like to invite you to stand for the reading of the gospel lesson. From Matthew's gospel, the 24th chapter, beginning at verse 36. Speaking about Jesus' second coming, Jesus says, But about that day or hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. As it was in the days of Noah, so it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. For in the days before the flood, people were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, up to the day Noah entered the ark, and they knew nothing about what would happen until the flood came and took them all away. That is how it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. Two men will be in the field, one will be taken, the other left. Two women will be grinding with a handmill. One will be taken and the other left. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know on what day your Lord will come. But understand this. If the owner of the house had known at what time of night the thief was coming, he would have kept watch and would not have let his house be broken into. So you also must be ready, because the Son of Man will come at an hour when you do not expect him. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. I'm sure that many of us over the Thanksgiving day this past Thursday, around the table, heard different questions. Questions like, do you have your decorations up yet? Are you ready for Christmas?
Are you ready for Christmas? Have you done your Christmas shopping, perhaps? We all heard questions about how ready we are, and that's exactly what this passage of Scripture asks us. It asks us to be ready, and how ready are we for Advent? And not just Jesus' first Advent, but his second Advent. For we live in this in-between time between Jesus' first coming that we commemorate at Christmas, and in between the time when Jesus will come back in his glory as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Ready or not, Christmas is coming. Ready or not, Christmas is coming. And all of this passage of Scripture can be summed up in three things. Jesus is coming again. Only God the Father knows the timetable. That's number two. And number three, get ready. Number three, get ready. So there are two Advents, and his coming brings us hope. The word Advent means coming. It comes from the Latin Adventus, which comes from the Greek parousia, but it means coming. It is in Jesus' coming as a baby who can identify with all of us and every one of our vulnerabilities that we can find hope. And it's also in Jesus who comes again as King of Kings and Lord of Lords that we also find hope. So the very purpose of Jesus' coming to earth, to save us sinners, to die on the cross and be raised from the grave, is to give us hope so that we might live in hope. We live in a time that needs hope. With all the turmoil that's in the world, all the shootings that seem to take place every day, with all the fears and all of the heartache and heartbreaks, as I think about the parents of those students that were so brutally murdered at the University of Utah, can you imagine what these past days of Thanksgiving have been like? And oh, how the world needs hope as I think about the Ukraine, where the Russian missiles have taken out the power grid. And not only are they without electricity, they're without heat even in those cold regions of the world. Oh, we need hope. We need hope not only around the world, but we need hope here in the United States, and we need hope here in Aiken. We need hope in all of our lives. That Jesus' first Advent brings us hope because he is a God who is not unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but because he is one of us, God who is with us, he knows everything that we have endured and brings us hope. And because he's coming again, we know that those hopes will be fulfilled and everything will be made right and everything will be straightened out. And so we use candles during this season of Advent. We have our Advent wreath, and each one of those candles represents 1,000 years. Each one of those candles, those four candles surrounding the white Christ candle that we will light on Christmas Eve and again on Christmas Sunday, December the 25th, those four candles. The first candle today is the candle of hope. The second candle will be the candle of peace. The pink candle is the candle of joy for Gaudet Sunday, and that's why it's a different color. And then the fourth candle, the candle of love, all representing 1,000 years or 4,000 in total that the sons of Adam and the daughters of Eve have been waiting for a Savior to come. And so today we celebrate that hope that God fulfills God's promises. God fulfills God's promises. Oh, we need hope. Remember the movie, It's a Wonderful Life? It was not a box office success. It cost about $3.1 million to make. It only made about $3.3 million, not even enough to cover the advertising. It was a failure in terms of the box office. But in terms of our hearts and minds, most of us know It's a Wonderful Life is a staple of our holiday season. And I wonder why that is. But let's think about the story for just a moment. We might be able to better answer that question. George Bailey, wanted to see the world, maybe in the military, maybe in business. He wanted to see the world, but because he saved his little brother Harry from drowning and he lost his hearing, he wasn't able to travel. Couldn't take the pressure, the air pressure, either in a plane or any other way. So he stayed at home in Bedford Falls, and he ran the Bailey Brothers Savings and Loan. And of course, his arch nemesis was Mr. Potter and his bank, a commercial bank. Not saying there's anything wrong with commercial banks versus savings and loans, but you know the story of Bailey Brothers and how on a Christmas Eve, they found themselves about to be visited by the bank examiner. And everybody has an Uncle Billy, it seems. And Uncle Billy in the movie, It's a Wonderful Life, he does the unthinkable. He wraps up the deposit that's to be taken to Potter's bank, but he wants to try to rub it in finally against Mr. Potter and brag about how Harry, George's little brother, has won the Medal of Honor because he saved thousands of lives as they were on a Navy ship. And as an aviator, he took out a kamikaze Japanese plane that was about to hit one of those ships. And so he opens the newspaper when he arrives at Potter's office to make the deposit to cover the liabilities of the savings and loan of Bailey Brothers. And when he does, the money falls out. He loses it. He loses the money, and Potter finds it, of course. And Uncle Billy looks everywhere, and he comes back to George and explains what's happened. He doesn't know where the money is, and George, he can't think of anything to do. So what he does is he takes out his life insurance policy and goes to Potter, and he says, "Can you take my life insurance policy as collateral?" And Potter refuses. Potter refuses. And so what does George do? He goes home to marry his beloved wife, played by Donna Reed. So there are Jimmy Stewart and Donna Reed, but George is in no shape to enjoy the sounds of his children and the laughter on this Christmas Eve in Bedford Falls. Zuzu, his little daughter, his youngest child, has the sniffles. And so he's overcome by that, and then the phone rings, if you remember the story, and it's Zuzu's teacher who calls to see how little Zuzu is doing, and George, like many parents who are upset by other things, takes it out on the teacher, and God bless all you teachers who've been put in that position. And George takes it out on her, his frustrations, not knowing what to do. It gets so rough in the telephone conversation that the teacher's husband gets on the line and says, "The next time I see you, I'm going to knock your block off." George hangs up. He goes to a place he doesn't usually go. He goes to the neighborhood bar. He sits there and he prays. And he says first, before he says his actual prayer, he says, "I'm not a praying man, but God, will you show me the way?" And two friends of his show up beside him and say, "We know the way. You need to go home, George. You need to get out of here." But there's a grumpy man sitting beside him. He's been there the whole time. And his two friends, George's two friends, by calling him by name, this grumpy man beside him knows that his name is George Bailey. And guess who he is? The teacher's husband. And so he turns around and whacks George across the mouth. His mouth is bloody as he picks himself up from the floor. And he says, looking toward heaven, "I guess that's what I get for praying." And in desperation, he gets in his car, crashes it, heads to the bridge over the river outside of Bedford Falls, and decides to do the unthinkable. He jumps into the water, the icy waters. And then there's another splash, and an angel named Clarence Oddbody. Isn't Oddbody a great name for an angel? I guess an angel has an odd body after all. And anyway, Clarence, who's trying to earn his wings, tries to help George. But George says another thing that's almost as unthinkable as the act that he had thought about committing. George says, "I wish I was never born. I wish I was never born." And then for the rest of the main part of the movie, we see vignettes of how Bedford Falls has gone from being named Bedford Falls to being named Pottersville. It becomes a place of vice and villainy. Because there was no George Bailey. Harry doesn't grow up to be a fighter pilot and win the Medal of Honor. And all those thousands of men on that Navy ship go to their deaths because Harry wasn't saved by George in that swimming accident. Because George was never born. And so many different things were changed about Bedford Falls. It wasn't the same place. But worst of all, the thing that got George's attention is when he runs across Mary Hatch, who had become, in real life, not this pretend kind of life where he didn't exist. She becomes Mary Bailey. But he runs across Mary, who doesn't look the same at all. She's not vivacious. She's not full of life. She's not smiling. She looks like a washed out individual. She's never married. She's lost. It breaks George's heart. And he finds Clarence and he says, "I want to live again. I want to live again." And of course he does. And you know how the movie ends. The whole town, as George makes his way, and he's smiling, he's full of joy, he's left behind the despair. And the whole town has brought all their money and all their donations, and they've got a washtub that's being filled with money. Even the grumpy bank examiner who's counting money, he reluctantly and begrudgingly takes out money and puts it in the big bucket. And George is holding little Zuzu beside the Christmas tree, and little Zuzu hears a bell ring on the Christmas tree and whispers in her father's ear, "They say that when a bell rings, it means that an angel has received their wings." And Clarence gets his wings, and George has a wonderful life. Why do we resonate? It wasn't a box office success, but why do we resonate? Why do we identify? Why do we like It's a Wonderful Life, that movie, so much? I believe it's because all of us have been filled with despair. All of us have been hopeless at one time or another. All of us have perhaps not been on the edge of the bridge, but we've been on the edge of despair. And we have Advent and this candle of hope to remind us that hope is fulfilled. That the 4,000 years that the sons of Adam and the daughters of Eve waited for the first coming of Jesus, those hopes were fulfilled. And so we read from the prophet Isaiah about hope in Isaiah chapter 42. Is speaking a prophecy about Jesus. "Here is my servant, Jesus. Here is my servant whom I uphold," says God, "my chosen one in whom I delight. I will put my spirit on him, and he will bring justice to the nations, justice to the people of Iran who are dying in the streets daily, protesting the Ayatollah's government, justice to the nations. The people who are dying in China because their government, their communist government, is cracking down on them once again." He says, "I will put my spirit on him and he will bring justice to the nations. He will not shout or cry out or raise his voice in the streets." And get this, "A bruised reed he will not break." How many of us feel like a bruised reed? And then it says, as I think about candles, "And a dimly burning wick He will not snuff out. How many of us identify not only with George Bailey, but this passage of Scripture, and we have become dimly burning wicks, candles in the wind, snuffed out. But it says about Jesus, a dimly burning wick, he will not snuff out. In faithfulness, he will bring forth justice. He will not falter or be discouraged until he establishes justice on the earth. In his teachings, the lands will put their hope. Hope. Oh, hope. So how do we receive hope? Two ways. Two ways. First of all, from this passage of Scripture, it says, wake up. Wake up. Wake up. You know, Queen Elizabeth II, I made mention of her last week. I'll do it again today. Queen Elizabeth II was known by her subjects in the United Kingdom for having some quirky little things about her. I mean, for instance, she had her interesting wave. I can't even dare do it. I won't even try. She wore her interesting hats that were a bit quirky, seemed to me out of sorts. She had her corgis, and I can't decide if corgis are beautiful or not. But on September the 19th, at her funeral, in King George's Chapel at Windsor Castle, they found out one more of her quirks. Because at King George's Chapel, at King George's Chapel, as her coffin was being lowered into the royal vault, as her coffin was being lowered, there was a bagpiper playing a tune. Now, what people found out, and you may already know this if you watch the service on September the 19th, is that Queen Elizabeth II had a royal piper whom every morning at 7 a.m., sometimes it might be a little bit later, but every morning for 70 years of her reign, this royal piper would play the same tune. The tune was a tribute to the royal fender smith. And you probably don't know, like I didn't know, what is a fender smith? I've listened to the tune. It's an upbeat tune. But this piper at her funeral is playing this song, a tribute to the royal fender smith. A fender smith is the person who polishes the fenders on the side of a fireplace and the fire back so that the fireplace sends its heat out into the room and to the people who are there. That is what her life was, is to be a royal fender smith herself, to reflect God's love in her heart and her devotion, as she said, to her subjects. And so this piper played this tribute to the royal fender smith, and then he turned around and walked out, still playing as it faded to those listening. But it wasn't a fade of mourning and sadness. It was a fading of glory, because this was her waking up music. Every morning for 70 years, she had a bagpiper outside of her window, wherever she was, playing this tune as her personal alarm clock, her waking up music. Waking up to glory. Waking up to glory. That same glory that will be for all of us who believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. That same glory, so that we don't have to give in to despair, so that we can lay hold of hope and hang on to it, because God's got waking up music for us. Hope fulfilled. So we not only have to wake up, and we have our personal alarm clock in Jesus, who wakes us up, brought you here this morning. Well, wake you up again, I pray, tomorrow, and keep waking us up until we wake up on the other side of glory, like Queen Elizabeth II rejoined with our Prince Philip, or whomever it may be. So we're to get awake, we're to wake up, and we're to get ready. Get ready. That's what Matthew 24 says. If you want to have hope, get ready. Get ready. And how do we get ready? It's the simple things that being a Christian means. I mean, we believe in Jesus, but we believe that God doesn't save us through Jesus to leave us the way he found us. And so there are ways that we keep getting ready. What are those ways? Well, we read the instruction manual, for one. We say our prayers, not like George did, where it seemed to bounce off the ceiling, but we say our prayers. We read the Bible. We worship together. We give of our time and our talents. We give our financial resources. We do our part to love God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love our neighbor as ourselves. It's pretty simple, isn't it, actually, to do unto others as you would have them do unto you. It's pretty simple with the power of the Holy Spirit living inside of us for us to get ready. And it's actually quite simple, but so difficult when we try to do it by ourselves. So we need the Lord to help us get ready. We need the Lord to help us stay on the ball. Stay on the ball. You know, used to say that a lot. Stay on the ball. Do you know where that phrase came from, staying on the ball? It's an interesting phrase. Maybe you've heard of Webster clay ball, but maybe you haven't. But perhaps you've heard, with all of this time change stuff, as they try to deal with that in Congress, Lord help them, in many ways. Back in the 1880s, there were 300 different time zones in the United States. Can you imagine? 300 different time zones? And the primary mode of transportation in the 1880s was the railroad. And I know we've heard rumors of a railway strike, and we don't need that to happen and disrupt our supply chain again. But 300 time zones, finally there had been so many different train accidents because you had trains running at different schedules, different time zones, it was crazy, and they were running on the same tracks, and so there were so many collisions, thousands lost their lives from train accidents. And so railway owners got together and decided that the United States would have four time zones. There would be Eastern Time, Central Time, Mountain Time, and Pacific Time. But then they had one more problem. What's the right time? How do we get everybody on the same time and the same schedule? I mean, remember that Chicago song? Does anybody really know what time it is? They didn't know. And so they found a guy who was a watchmaker turned watch salesman who had a factory, and his name was Webster Clay Ball, the Ball Watch Company. Now, it wasn't as big as Waltham or Elgin or Longines or Hamilton, but they had good watches. As a matter of fact, they set the standard for correct time, so much so that Longines and Hamilton and Waltham and Elgin all followed and agreed to that the way to keep all these train accidents from happening so they would have accurate time was to let Webb Ball, they called him Webb, to let Webb Ball teach them how to make watches. And because of that, every conductor on every train, every person in every station, everybody with schedules, everybody who set the times for the trains used a Ball watch. And that's how we have our phrase, on the ball. On the ball means being on the ready. On the ball means getting it done. On the ball means getting ready. On the ball means making sure you're doing your part and doing it the best you can. It means on time. Are you on the ball? How ready are you? How ready are you for Christmas? You know, we used to tell our children, you gotta wait. And during the earlier parts of the year, we've all said, Christmas is coming, but it sure is slow. And we would talk about somebody who was not very fast, they're slow as Christmas. Well, it's too late. It's not slow anymore. It's around the corner. Ready or not, Christmas is coming. I hope that we all are found to be ready, not only to celebrate Jesus' first coming, but to be ready for him to come again. In that certainty that he's coming again, in this in-between time, we have hope. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we pray for your angels to watch over us. They may not be Clarence Oddbodies, but Lord, we want you to help us and show us the way. We want to wake up and listen to you, the royal piper, ready to sound our waking up music to eternal life. And we want to get ready, and we want to be on the ball. Help us, Lord Jesus, to be prepared. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 196, appropriately, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus. Would you stand as you're able? Hope of God, the strength of God, the encouragement that comes from hope, abide in you now and forever. Through God the Father, the Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.